Hi everybody, welcome to the Dead Horse Podcast, and joining me today are Vivek.
Hey.
And Arvind.
Hello.
So what's up, you guys?
Well, I've been playing Banner Saga and a bunch of other games like Prison Architect, The Bridge, and some other games which like I don't remember, but yeah, basically these games.
Okay. You beat Banner Saga.
Yeah, I finished Banner Saga. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, like no spoilers, okay? Because I have to start the game and I'm waiting to start the game.
What did you think of the ending, Arvind?
Like, it was okay, I guess. Like, I mean, like, I didn't... because, like, I guess most of the stuff isn't even resolved. Like, it's... Like,
yeah.
None of, like, the overarching threat is resolved and you don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
So, I mean, like, I was only pissed that, like, somebody who I spent, like, a lot of time leveling, like, I wouldn't be able to use them anymore. So, that's what my general...
She said no spoilers, you dick.
Yeah, so it's not a spoiler. Like, yeah, it's still, like, very vague as to what it is. So.
Yeah, like, I didn't get what he said, so...
Okay, I guess. It's interesting. Any standout moments for you apart from the like? I thought the like it has easily one of the best cutscenes I've ever seen. The first cutscene where the Jarl starts talking about the world after the fight in his hall. That was pretty amazing.
Yeah, my brother was watching like the intro and he was like, "Did Disney make this game?" Because like it really looks like Disney made this game. Like,
the artwork is
probably
amazing.
Yeah, like it's like basically golden age Disney, you know, like.
Yeah,
so,
I think
yeah, like,
I won't be surprised if the guys who worked on it are, you know, ex-Disney or something, because the art is absolutely gorgeous. It's what?
Yeah.
Ex-aware.
Yeah, but maybe like at some point they probably like snagged somebody.
Yeah.
I actually saw. In the credits, like, there is a separate, like, a studio with, like, that did the animations. Like, it was, like, animation.
Yeah.
So I imagine those people also outsourced for, like, Pixar or somebody, I don't know. Like,
the
music was great.
These guys are, they've come through Kickstarter.
Yeah, like, I remember the Kickstarter. Yeah, actually, yeah, just, like, I actually like pledged for it, but then like had to remove my pledge at the last minute because like I had already pledged for like at that time there was like Wasteland 2 and something else, Double Fine Adventure, I think. So,
okay.
But yeah, so the art is great. The music is pretty great as well. Like,
yeah, so I like the underlying systems, and I think my only kind of small beef with them is that they're pretty shallow. Especially the systems where, like, you know, you're traveling with the group and you need to manage the food supplies and stuff, the Oregon Trail stuff that they have going.
Yeah,
I have a feeling that could have been more
substantial.
It could have been more substantial.
How are the character developments in the game, like any remember characters you would recommend? Remember?
Oh, I mean, I would tell you, but then like it would be a spoiler. Like,
yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's not something.
No, so yeah, there's one like really like moment where like it feels like a punch to your stomach, basically.
There's
you haven't
one,
been expecting it.
Completely shocking moment that comes out of nowhere. I don't know if we're talking about the same moment, but whatever.
Yeah, no, I think I'm talking about the same moment because I talked about it with you earlier as well. Like,
yeah, okay. There are some really interesting characters in it too, but I don't think we should start talking about whom we like and whom we dislike because then start discussing the plot.
Yeah, no, that's actually like one of those things which I actually don't like about this is that ultimately, like I was only attached to like the two characters who you see on the title screen. Otherwise, like I was indifferent to everyone else pretty much because, like most like some of these characters like disappear for a long amount of time, and then like some of them, like just like then pop in later on, and like I had completely forgotten that like I used to fight with them. Like for example, like there is this prince character who is like as a like you know a very rude kind of person, but he's amazing at combat. Like he was the cornerstone of stone of my combat strategy. And then like
I see.
suddenly like so like he was there for the
Thieves.
first 25% of the game, then like he's just gone and doesn't show up until the final boss. So that felt weird to me because like I had built my squad around this guy.
Wait
And
a
then like
second.
he's just gone.
He
Yeah.
showed up for you in the final boss?
Yeah, he showed up at the final boss, yeah.
Huh.
But literally like at the final boss, like not even like one battle before the final boss. Right at the
Oh.
final boss battle.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah,
Interesting.
because I had leveled him up to like maximum. I had spent all my renown on like making him the character and everyone else. So like everyone else would basically absorb damage and lower their shields. Or like
Okay.
what do you call that armor, the blue thing, and then he would basically because he was diagonals, so like he would be shielded, nobody would attack him, so I had raised his attack and then he would like one shot everyone, so that was my strategy, but then
Oh.
like so then but yeah, but and like towards the end actually like the final one thirds of the game. I was in the final stretch of the caravan and I had no food because I had made the cardinal sin of buying one item because I bought one item for 20 renown, which is the currency in the game. Like that basically meant I couldn't level up anyone in my party. I couldn't buy any food. I couldn't buy like and like everyone kept dying, so that felt weird to me. Like if buying one item that wasn't even that great actually could like imbalance your like entire caravan so much, then like I think like the whole trading system like shouldn't even be there. Like that's my opinion at least. Because really like
I think it should be there. I think I'd have just been. I think you and me would have both been more comfortable if we traded with actual money and renown was used for leveling up the characters, right?
That would actually make sense because like I mean like because of this renown stuff, like in the first half of the game I couldn't afford any items. Like I would go up to a merchant would be like the three items shown there would be like 25 renown, 15 renown, and like one of them would be like five or so. So the good items would be too expensive. And then later on the first item I could like I thought okay I can afford this item, let's buy it. And then like suddenly the rest of the game from then on was completely spoiled because of that one thing. So yeah, like I'd actually consider like money because that way you can actually like buy items for every one of your
Yeah, I'd
characters and
really like
like
to know what the design reasoning was behind having renown be the one common currency for with which you buy everything. Like I don't understand that. I think adding money would probably have made it more interesting because now you have another factor that you have to constantly manage for your entire caravan. The last boss was one of the most irritating boss battles I've had to go through in a long time. I died a lot.
I actually, yeah, like funnily enough, like since I actually got it right in my first try because I opened a wiki to deal with how to deal with this
Ah,
guy.
yeah, I did that. It took me a long time to figure out that I was doing something wrong and. Like, I recommend opening a wiki for the final boss because it's not clear immediately what you have to do.
Oh,
Mm.
no, I mean, though to be fair, like they previously like hint a lot, but yeah, like still, like because of the way the final boss can just regen everything, so you want to like get it right in the first try, because after that, like because I don't think this game has healing items. Like there are simply no healing items, right?
No.
Yeah. So that means that if you like if you spend too long, then that's basically guaranteed death.
Yeah. This game has so many interesting things at a surface level that just like there's that lack depth. Like that caravan thing at a surface level is really interesting. Managing the renown stuff so that people can eat and you can level up your fighters is interesting. I imagine that's why it's one currency, because they want you to choose. I imagine the idea was you have to choose between leveling up your fighters or feeding your caravan and keeping everyone alive. I imagine that's what they wanted to
Yeah.
have be the dilemma that players face. But I think they made a mistake, because honestly, it's probably a lot more interesting where if the like you know what you can still have that dilemma wherein like you know if you keep money, you use renown to level them up and get them you know new levels of the attacks and stuff that they have to do in their special moves. But money can use to buy them new equipment, or you can use the
Yeah.
money to buy food for your caravan and you
Yeah, I
can.
mean, I was pretty surprised because I was like, after completing the game, I was like reading the wiki just to know what happens if like you choose something else and what happens if you do this. And like I was like the wiki's first warning is don't buy items using like in the entire game. So I was like, yeah,
Why?
like no, because like just because I told. So like it's just weird. Like items like they clearly like they didn't like play test that thing enough, I think, because otherwise, yeah, like I mean, and what I would have done was like when your clansmen and your soldiers etc. are dying, it doesn't really affect anything beyond like make the battle slightly harder. So I would have probably done so that like so if you, for example, if your caravan is starving, so then if you don't feed them properly, then one of your heroes dies, and then another dies, and so on and so forth. That would probably make it like more like concerning.
Yeah,
Because
for
like
sure.
because towards the end, what happened, like I had everyone leveled up at max. I had my party like with Rook and Alette and all of those other people, like the that one Varl guy. So like it didn't matter to me, like everyone kept dying and I just kept winning the battles. So that took out a lot of the stress for me. Because my morale was at absolute rock bottom and everyone was dying.
Yeah,
But it
I
didn't
don't
matter
know. Like,
because yeah.
I definitely think that these guys need to take a long, hard look and play Expeditions Conquistador, because it did a lot of these things better than what they're doing.
Yeah. I actually, yeah, like I like, yeah, Expeditions did some of these things better, but it was a lot less polished than
It
this.
was a
Like,
lot less polished. It did not have like Expeditions' narrative is much more player driven than it is designer driven, right? Like the narrative is driven
Yeah.
by like your choices and all that stuff. But this is like this they had a story they wanted to tell, and like I'm amazed at how well they tell it. You know, for all the problems that I think it has at a systemic level and stuff, they tell that story really, really damn well. Like this is one of the first fantasy stories I've played in a long time that is literally at the level of a good fantasy book, you know? Like I felt like I was reading a really, really good book at times, and I hope they don't take that as a slight or whatever. Like I enjoyed that game.
Yeah, it was very much because of the visuals and because while it was like very grand adventure-y, it wasn't it didn't particularly require any understanding beneath the surface level. So in that sense, it was a lot like a children's book where like everything is grand and it's basically like Lord of the Rings, I guess. Except like imagine if like somebody thought I'll write a new Lord of the Rings, but I won't use any Lord of the Rings stuff in it. So it was actually quite enjoyable because you had this new, like all of these races were new, like there were no fucking elves for once, thank God.
Or
So,
dwarves.
yeah, not those either. So, and like while the Dredge were pretty similar to Reapers, like in Mass Effect,
Looked very, very
sort of.
different.
No, I mean, no, like they were actually the husk, basically. And the big worm guy was the Reaper. That's what felt like. But no, but they were well presented. And like there was one shocking revelation as to like how one character got their fame, which was
Yeah.
well done, I think. Yeah.
Then like that has very like it has a very enjoyable plot. I think they did a good job.
Yeah.
The Banner Saga, people should play that game. It's a fun game.
Yeah. I think ultimately like I think it's a great game, but it's one of those where you feel that like ultimately, like there wasn't enough time or like something else just like felt which is
Missing.
why they weren't able to. Yeah, no, I wouldn't say missing, more like unpolished. Like
Okay.
everything to make a amazing strategy game, for example, is there. But like
Uh-huh.
just like the economy like was like you feel if they had like more time and money, they probably would have sorted out this item stuff. Because like it's not like these people don't know like how to balance this thing, right? So
Yeah, I
yeah, I
agree.
think ultimate yeah. I'd probably like be like yeah, like I imagine at some point in this game there definitely was a money resource that was separated. Because renown seems like the game is very stingy with it, renown. But
Yeah.
at the same time, like it feels like some of these things clearly were made designed for money. Like for example, trading with renown doesn't make any sense. Like
Well, I
so
mean,
because
like
renown, yeah.
they never clearly come out and say it, but I always assumed that your name allows you to get this stuff for free. I assume that's what that's what it meant.
It could be, I guess, yeah. So, yeah, that's pretty much like our thoughts on Banner Saga, I guess.
Yeah. You also played the bridge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the bridge is basically like the bridge, or as I call it, the braid, is basically like a game that wishes it was braid very hard. And like wants the best to become braid somehow. Like the start is exactly the same as Braid. Like your character is standing there, like the no main menu kind of thing. You walk, and then the game starts. And like at the first time, there are a few doors. You enter one of them, and like when you enter the door, there is a text-based story thing, which is just like 4 or 5 lines of vague text that's about somebody's personal journey. And then the game has the infinite rewind thing from Braid. And like the keys look like Braid, the locks look like Braid, the doors look like Braid. And like the game's blurb, the thumbnail on Steam is somebody like saying that I haven't played a good puzzle game like this since Braid. So yeah, like I'd seriously yeah, so yeah, like clearly like the person who made this has a chip on their shoulder or like really, really loves Braid or something. But otherwise, yeah, I mean, it's a good puzzle game. Like, it's a good puzzle game. Has a basic. The thing is that the puzzles are like Braid again, but with MCS. Like, I don't know how to pronounce it, but it's like, those 2D
Sure.
drawings, which. Yeah, Escher, yeah. Like, those 2D drawings where it's like an impossible staircase that if you, like, follow, you can keep climbing up. And
Okay.
sometimes there's, like, you've seen those drawings, right? Like there's
M.C.
another
Escher.
where it's,
I'll give you guys a link so that you can see his style.
yeah. It's basically stuff that makes like that looks Fox 3D, but can only be drawn in a 2D plane. So it uses that for its puzzles. So
That
you have
impossible
to.
staircase stuff is nuts, man.
Yeah, I mean the game is very well drawn. It's entirely black and white, very like drawn like a pencil sketch, and it's
Oh.
very well drawn, like very well polished. I like the visual style. Like to me, like ultimately, like it just so happens that I have played Braid before. So like a lot of the game stuff just like feels like retreading the same old kind of thing. Even though it's not like, but still like, yeah, I guess it's good. Like I got it for like $1 and I would definitely recommend people if it's like for $1, even if for like 4 or 5. So yeah, like it's a perfectly adequate puzzle game.
I'm just looking at the screenshots at the moment and I get what you mean. Looks like it's pencil drawn or something. Seriously. Amazing.
No, yeah, the visuals are very well done. Yeah, I actually think that like it's one of those things where like it's like fixation on Braid might have actually like hindered it, because like they could have been more weird, like than what they ended up with. I think it's not bad by any means, but it's just like, yeah, but then like I'm just like psychoanalyzing, maybe this person just like it's entirely unintentional that like the Braid thing, but I don't know.
Could be. So what,
Yeah, Rashi,
how
you
is
were
Prison Architect?
okay. Prison Architect. So
Yeah.
it's like
I've
it's
heard about that game before.
I mean, I guess it's like SimCity, but like you make a prison instead.
I don't know that it's like SimCity, man. Like the it is SimCity meets The Sims.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, you can call it that. Yeah.
But for prisons.
Yeah.
So like you
The
have
intro is
to make
actually
sure
quite.
the convicts don't escape and stuff.
Yeah. So like the game is basically an open sandbox. You can set your aims. For example, you can set a failure condition. So if like too
Okay.
many convicts escape or like lots of other stuff, your prison makes up a loss and other things, then there's a game over screen. Otherwise, you can just continue. It evokes that Dwarf Fortress thing, because like at some point things will go wrong in your prison, and like you'll probably
Obviously.
laugh at your misfortune, stuff like that.
Yeah, you like it's almost impossible. Like it's not impossible, but it's hard to run a perfect prison because they like the game will find a way to trip you up, you know.
And
Like
basically no, go ahead.
I heard that right now what he's working on is the kind of like eventually this is like the end game shit he's working on is that eventually you'll get a Clint Eastwood type of prisoner from Escape from Alcatraz who will find an ingenious way to escape from your prison, no matter what you build. I think that's amazing.
Though I guess like that would probably be like pretty easy for him to do, considering like he's the designer, so he can
Yeah.
probably like make a prisoner that
Yeah.
no, but like what the game's engaging in that like you basically have to take care of like all their like the needs of the prisoners, but at the same time, like instead of the Sims, where like the Sims are like 100% will do whatever you want them to, like won't ever complain. I mean, I guess they would complain, like Sims complain, but like they don't resist. Here, like if you don't build rooms for your prisoners, they'll get unhappy and they'll like fight, or they'll run away when the guards are not looking.
Yeah. Okay. They can
So
even riot.
it's yeah.
You have
And
to build, like, I mean, there are certain things that you have to do, which early on you think you can think you've taken for granted, but like you have to build
like
enough toilets for everyone to use. You have to build, you have to. No, it becomes a problem. I'm not kidding. It becomes
it's important. Yeah, like yeah, no, the
Okay.
importance cannot be understated, because like if like people can't go to the toilet on time, they'll get angry and then they'll riot, because that's realistic, right? Like
Oh God, that is
yeah.
hilarious.
You have to be able to serve them clean food. Like there are
Yeah,
things that this.
like your canteen needs to be big enough, because like what happens is like you like prisoners get one meal more in the morning and then one in the evening. So like if your canteen can only house like 20 people and you have like 40 prisoners, then maybe 10 prisoners or so won't be able to eat. So then they'll get angry. And like the
And then
next
there'll be
time, like
fights.
prisoners will, like I like pr some prisoners will start fighting amongst themselves in order to like get to the canteen line first. So
अच्छा
like it's very like morbid, I guess, like in some ways, because like the game acknowledges like this in the intro, that like the subject matter is like quite touchy. And like at this point, I'm not like the game treats it very like, I guess, impartially. Like you can pretend like this is basically The Sims, and instead of the prisoners you get like you are like running a college hostel, because it's basically the same thing more or less. So
Okay.
Well, come on. Come on now. I know you didn't like college, but it's not basically the same thing.
yeah, I mean, yeah, prisons are better, but yeah,
I
sure.
imagine that the prison has a lot more assault happening than there was in college.
Yeah. No, but yeah, like that was actually, yeah, just tongue in cheek, but yeah. But yeah, like yeah, at this point, like after a while, like you just run out of things to do, and eventually like you can only basically sell your prison and then build a new one, a bigger one at the start.
Oh, so you can
So
sell
right
the
now
prison as
the
well.
yeah, like that's the right now, since like the game is like in early access and there's no end game as such. So the end game
Acha.
basically amounts to like you build your prison, you get more money based on the number of prisoners you have in your prison. So and like you get more money if you house a high security prisoner than if you house a low security or a normal security one. So right now you can only basically like sell your prison and then start with the extra money that you get to build a bigger, better prison. So yeah, I'm interested in seeing like how the end game shapes up. But yeah,
Interesting.
otherwise, I mean, yeah, it's a good like if you like the Sims and SimCity kind of games, then like it's a definite play. What I actually want is like because like since the topic like of prisons does is kind of uncomfortable, I want somebody to like you know do go sort of the majesty route and just like make another something like you are like, I don't know, like some evil boss and like have to design your
But then you
dungeon.
won't have to, like, I don't know, like, you can do this for, I guess a crime family, but then I don't know why you have to sit down and worry about toilets.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I mean, this
Well,
is.
like, I don't know, it could be if you're doing something like, I don't know, like outside of the usual strategy thing where you do a military simulator, it's very hard to find the exact place where you can do something like this. I think an interesting one will be that space-based DS9, that Double Fine ability.
Yeah, that kind of thing. Yeah, I was just actually remembering when you said gangster. I played another game. It's called Omerta, like City of Gangsters. And like, yeah, I didn't enjoy that game at all.
Yeah, I know. It was disappointing considering it was made by guys who have made an amazing version of what we're talking about called Tropico.
Yeah.
The Omerta guys are Hemimont Games. I don't know where they're based, but somewhere in
Yeah.
Europe. They're out of Europe. They make this amazing series of games called Tropico in which you play the dictator. I keep
Yeah.
saying detector instead of dictator. The dictator of this import
Yeah.
republic, that basically your goal is to make as much money as possible and funnel it into your Swiss bank account and leave the country bankrupt. So you got to find different ways to do that in a limited amount of time.
Yeah, no, I actually think that like Omerta guys, like they started out like wanting to like make an XCOM but with gangsters, sort of. Because like but the combat like doesn't work for me at all. Like I find simple functions in that like very complicated for some reason.
XCOM with gangsters sounds like the perfect game for me.
Yeah, but it isn't. Like the execution isn't there.
Dude! Like, XCOM, which is basically like gangsters versus aliens, and
Oh,
like
right. Oh, like that.
gangs of Vasepur versus aliens.
I actually think like I was like thinking about that, isn't like you could make an XCOM where you play as Exalt. That's basically what you're saying, like.
No, I'm saying Manoj Bajpayee kills aliens.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure there's some B movie out there that's exactly like this, and it's horrible.
I'm sure there's a really, really shitty B movie out there, like, but it doesn't have Manoj Bajpayee in it. It doesn't have anyone from Gang of Wasseypur in it. Probably doesn't have anyone from Gang of Wasseypur in it. That would be a fun movie. That would be a fun game for the 20 minutes that I played it before I forget about it forever.
Yeah, but really, the idea actually reminds me of this game that's called Marlowe Briggs and the Mask of Death or something like. Because like it's a game which has like this one idea and it runs with it for 8 hours, out of which the first 2 hours are actually enjoyable, and the rest of that is where the idea is run dry, and it just keeps repeating the same joke again and again, in the hopes that you laugh. So
I
yeah,
think
like.
Marlowe Briggs should have been maybe 3 hours long and just loaded itself with every gag that it had in those 3 hours. And
Yeah.
people would have appreciated it a lot more. It's
Yeah.
not a
It
bad game,
stretches
but
itself too much. Yeah.
yeah, it's not a bad game, but it stretches too long.
Yeah. Like, I mean, because it could have been a lot, like the game like plays some stuff straight and then like some of the like explosion stuff, but in the end you've seen it all and the enemies are just reskinned versions of the old ones. So yeah. So anyway, like speaking of disappointments, Rashi, you played Assassin's Creed 4, right?
Oh,
Did you
yes.
finish?
And it's a
Yeah, so tell us
disappointment, as
about
I
the
always.
game.
The story is, it's not, what's the word? It doesn't hold you, you know? It doesn't, you don't feel like playing it. It's just there. And the only reason that I was playing the game was because of the naval battles, which I know you suggested that those are the only good things about the game. But then they get repetitive as well again, so
Yeah, like
it's like why am I doing this?
the key I found to enjoying that game is you got to mix it up. Like you got to do. I used to play it like I used to do 30 minutes of naval stuff, which is just sailing around the sea, and if I found anyone, I'd blow them out of the water, and then I'd stop at this island and run around and shoot some animals.
Yeah,
And
that's
then
what I was doing.
I'd have this weird Ubisoft pop up that said you should skin shit, and I was like, no, fuck this, I'm not playing this game, and I shut it off. Because I don't want to see friggin' Far Cry shit while playing Assassin's Creed, you know?
Yeah, I
And
mean, they've added this thing.
even in Far Cry, that thing really pissed me off. The number of pop-ups they had telling me, you know, you can do this, you can kill animals to craft stuff. And I'm like,
Yeah,
yes, I
yeah.
know, but it's why are you popping up every 5 minutes? It's really irritating.
Seriously, seriously. At times it would pop up at all the wrong places, and there's
Yeah.
this guy hiding in the bushes, and I'm like, okay, dude, where did he come from? It's because he was hidden by a pop-up. It got frustrating. True
Yes.
that.
So I decided to stop playing until I
Yeah.
could.
But I decided to carry on till the end of Edward Kenway's story. I don't know what happens in the present day story that was going on in parallel. The last time that I remember, the last thing that I remember is that this guy John or whoever he is like, you know, going crazy, and he's like sort of kidnapped you, and he dies, and people are like storming in, and they're like, okay, it wasn't your fault, it was this guy's fault who was framing you. So did you even understand what I'm saying? Because
No, I
it was
had
like
no
really
idea.
confusing.
I lost complete interest in Assassin's Creed story
Seriously,
after Assassin's, like, I mean, I liked it until Assassin's Creed 2 when there was that big breaking the fourth wall moment. But after that, they've bought in too much to that like Lost style of storytelling where what is the next big thing that will happen? It's all like, no, dude, that's not why we're here. We're here for you to take us back into the past and tell us an interesting story in the past. That's why Ezio's story worked, because his story was rooted around him and the stuff that happened in the past, not because how it like Desmond is the shittiest part of that entire friggin' story. God, anyway, fuck, why am I talking about Assassin's Creed? Such a waste of time.
This actually, like, this discussion actually reminds me of this article I read about Assassin's Creed 3 recently, which was about that even though, like, the person played the game for like 60 hours, they didn't, they felt empty, like they felt like so, like, the thing was that, like, how much content is like not having content at all, basically. So, like, you play 60 hours of something and then you end up with the feeling that, like, you just wasted 60 hours of your life. And I think
that's
like,
what I felt.
Assassin's
Yeah,
Creed
that's
is...
what I felt. But
No,
I'll
go
say
ahead.
this, that the fourth game is much better than the third game. It's...
Oh, yeah. Like,
yeah, much better.
There's
I
no
mean, Assassin's
comparison.
Creed 3 was like, why am I playing this game? I literally felt like throwing the CD out of the window, you know? It was pathetic.
Assassin's Creed 3, like, based, like, they didn't have anything interesting with the missions there. Assassin's Creed 4, they've had the time and they've gone on to make at least a few interesting missions, which,
True.
you know what, you like, yeah, they've made, I think, I don't know, they've made, I think, 8 games now. I don't know how many fucking Assassin's Creed games have come out.
Six, I
But
guess.
at the rate at which they're going to be more Assassin's Creeds than Final Fantasies before this decade is over. There will be more Assassin's Creed games because now it's 2 a year. They're releasing 2 a year
Yeah,
now.
Yeah.
2 a year.
That's insane. That's
Why?
insane.
Yeah. Like, that's even weird for me because, like for me, the appeal of Assassin's Creed in the games that I've played is always like navigating this really insanely detailed city. Like, you know,
Yeah.
like in Assassin's Creed 2, like that. That's why, like, I loved that game, even though the plot was nonsense. But still, like, I was in Venice and I was like in Renaissance Italy, where all this awesome stuff was happening, like a very like historically interesting place. And then the
Yeah.
first one was, you know, Jerusalem and like
Yeah.
the.
Yeah. Middle
But
East.
then like, yeah. But then like, I don't know what happened. Maybe like to cut costs, suddenly 3 was in a forest. Like, I mean, like, no disrespect to like 1700s America or something, but it doesn't compare to like Renaissance Italy. So, like, why
Yeah.
was that
Actually, I
period
guess we were
chosen?
too used to. I don't know, seriously. Tani. I don't know what thought. But
I think.
they wanted to make him climb trees. Because, you know, they
No,
discovered this new
I don't
technology.
think that was it. I think they wanted to appeal to an American audience, and that's why they set it in the American Revolution. The thing is, if you set it in the American Revolution, there's not a lot of great American buildings or architecture in that time in the United States. Like, they're not just settling in. They've been there for a while, but it's still pretty primitive, you know? It's still pretty harsh.
Yeah.
There's nothing to climb in that sense. So they have to make it trees.
Yeah. Trees or mountains or something.
Yeah. I don't know. I found it.
I mean, I would have made it like something like, I mean, if you're really out of ideas, just like make a feudal Japan or something. Like, that has lots of buildings to climb. So
yeah, it does.
A lot of people have been begging Ubisoft to make it in Japan, you know?
Feudal Japan, ancient Egypt. Like, some people are saying, why do you have to keep moving forward in time? Go back to Egypt.
Yeah,
and
no,
I
mean, ancient. Man, ancient Egypt actually sounds like a perfect idea. You already have all this like mysterious pyramid stuff. Make it so that like that was how the Templars were doing their thing. And if like 15 pyramids are made it so in this shape, then everything will
ancient
be doomed.
Ancient aliens.
Yeah. You know what would also be a great Assassin's Creed setting? Persia. They should try that.
But I
And
think they
like
were
make it
working
about
on
a
a Prince of
prince, like,
Persia
you know.
title that time.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
cool.
I mean, Assassin's Creed was Prince of Persia initially, right? Until they changed it.
Yeah.
I think they're making a new Prince of Persia also. Hopefully they do a good one now.
Yeah.
Or,
I
well,
haven't
I
heard
think
any news about
it. One.
I like the cel-shaded one. Though, like, I mean, at that time, I didn't like the cel-shaded one because, like, the platforming was simplified. And I felt like, you know, like there would be more Prince of Persias that would fix this. But then like they just stopped, and then I was like, well, and now I'm at the stage where I'll settle for any Prince of Persia.
Yeah,
So
same here. Same here. Like, you know what is going to happen? And this is like the ultimately shitty thing. They're going to release a Prince of Persia after like 5, 6 years. It is going to be extremely successful. And we're going to get one every year for the next 10 years from Ubisoft.
And then
Until
Civil
we're
War
so
2.
pissed off.
Yeah. But like what I don't get is like you have Assassin's Creed for your like simplified platforming, right? So now make the Prince of Persia for the one where like you actually had to like manually do the wall running thing. Because like wall running in itself like isn't awesome. The thing that you have to like use some skill to wall run is what makes it awesome.
That's what made it awesome for the Prince of Persia games, according to me.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean exactly like you like perfectly timing to like avoid like the you know like four or five like spinning blades and then wall running and then this that's what made it look awesome.
Yeah. And that was pretty challenging as well. And then
Yeah.
in the middle of the wall, there would be a creature there, so you have to basically wall run and then slice that creature and then continue doing a wall run.
Yeah,
So you
yeah.
have to time it perfectly, and if you don't, it'll just, you know, you'll fall down and stuff like that. That was
Yeah.
like, you know, you required skills for to do that. It's matlab, in the recent games, nothing as such.
Yeah.
Sure,
I
the
mean, they
naval
made.
battles is required skill, but otherwise, yeah.
Yeah. I guess
And if you
like
upgrade your
Ubisoft
ship,
is.
so na na bolo bolo.
No, continue. Like I was like not really like much of it. I was just
Ha
like doing some anti Ubisoft things.
ha. So like what I was saying was that even in the naval battles, if you upgrade your ship, it sort of you know you've won half the battle basically. So but in Prince of Persia, you don't really upgrade anything as such, and it's all your pure luck and your pure skills, and you know your which sort of helps you out. That's what I really liked about Prince of Persia.
Yeah. No, I mean, yeah, like what I would think is like, but then like again, I don't think like Ubisoft, but like what I would do is like your Prince of Persia is for your platforming stuff, you know, precision platforming kind of thing. You make your Assassin's Creed for the simplified open world thing where people explore like beautiful ancient periods or something. And then like you spin off Assassin's Creed into one naval battle thing or something like because like they seem to be like moving from a like one thing to another without any sense of like at this point like after four like they've completely lost track of what appealed to people when Assassin's Creed 1 came out.
It's not even that. Like, I think it's basically like they're trying, like I don't know, the earlier thing that you said, they're trying to make all their games one thing now. Just
Yeah,
smooth the
the one
production cycle.
Ubisoft design, yeah.
Yeah, just smooth the production cycle into like a completely efficient machine, right? I don't know, it's weird. And this is something you can observe throughout all their games. Like, you know, where the core idea
Yeah.
is actually pretty excellent. Like the core idea of making a kind of pirate game about naval combat, wherein like, you know, you're just a pirate traveling the sea, that's an excellent idea. And if
Yeah.
Assassin's Creed 4 was that, just that, like even with the Assassin's Creed skin on it would have been an excellent game. It's because they add all this bullshit of, you know,
Upgrading and like
the
collecting and all of that
seasons.
stuff, yeah.
Yeah, their meta games are horrible. Ubisoft's meta
Yeah.
games are horrible. The meat of the
Yeah.
game is fine. Like at its core, the game is fun. Those games are fun to play. But their meta
Yeah.
games are just horrible. But what's worse than that is that they're obnoxious and horrible because they're constantly shoved in your face.
Yeah.
And
And
so
I mean like
repetitive. They just keep repeating it so
Yeah.
much that I mean,
Yeah.
Watch Dogs, oh God.
Yeah,
Okay,
I mean
I'm
they should
back
have
to Watch
like
Dogs.
spun off like the pirate thing into like a game called Sea Dogs. Like it would be perfect, like their dogs franchise kind of thing take off. No, but like yeah, I think one of the reasons their upgrade systems don't work is that like Like when you upgrade something, you rarely get anything new. What you actually get is like plus five of something, or like plus
Yeah.
four of something. Like you can have, like in Far Cry 3, you can have like two, you can carry two more things if you craft this new backpack. So I
It's the
mean
same
that
thing in
doesn't really,
Assassin's Creed.
yeah. I mean you don't feel like what do you call like if you that you gained anything out of all this tedium. Like I mean if I level up, like if I go from level like to 10 to 20 in WoW, I'm wearing something like entirely new, and I have like four new abilities, I have this new awesome pet, and I can like do all of this new stuff. So I mean that actually felt like okay, like leveling up was worth it. But here it doesn't like feel that much.
The only time I use crafting is when I'm out of sleep darts and berserk darts, and then I open up the crafting menu and, craft a dart because that's what I really needed. So that's the only use for the crafting that I've found.
Yeah, that's the other thing, like for the crafting stuff that they have that I find really, really irritating is that they make you use it because you need it something for a mission, which you cannot get unless you craft it.
Yeah. Or you loot dead bodies.
Yeah, like I mean it's very, very hard to get it just by luck, by looting some corpse somewhere. It's I don't know, man. Like I find that their method of forcing that metagame collectible shit on people are very, very annoying. Yeah. And it's like I don't know, it's another trend I've observed this year is that like all the games that people have pinned almost their entire hopes on, like the big, the huge budget games, have turned out to be kind of consistently mediocre. Which is kind of sad. Titanfall, the like initially had a lot of buzz going for it, and it did some cool stuff, but like the buzz has died down. Watch Dogs was a disappointment for everyone, like very, very bland. And now Destiny is out, and the initial reports are that it's not a lot of like it's not it doesn't have anything new in terms of mission design. You wait
I
and
mean,
see, of
like
course.
for.
Destiny, it's too early to tell. It's an MMO. It takes time, of course. We'll find out what the
I
meaning of
mean,
the game.
the surprising thing that like most people are saying that like at least Titanfall tried to do something new. Like
Yeah.
Destiny doesn't even have the try bit in the
Yeah,
like.
I think the really surprising thing for me is that other than the fact that aesthetically it looks amazing, and I'm not like it is one of the first few games I've seen right now that makes me think, oh my God, like this is next gen. What I'm looking at, definitely next generation, and it doesn't seem like something that current consoles could run. That's the first thing that strikes me. But looking at like I watched a bunch of the Giant Bomb playthrough stuff. Like they have 4 hours of Destiny, them playing Destiny co-op, and the mission. I think the encounter design is what people are kind of pillorying Destiny for, because there's nothing new in the kind of encounters they're designing, and that kind of says like I'm a little bit disappointed, because initially when Destiny was pitched, I thought it would be kind of like a really, really big budget version of DayZ, wherein
Yeah, I
you're
mean
in
the fun
this
thing
world.
is that I mean, go ahead.
Like I thought you'd be in this really dangerous world with your friends or and with other strangers, and like really crazy shit could happen. I thought that's what Destiny was going to be, but it turns out it's basically.
I mean the fun thing is that when you say like repetitive encounters with nothing new, like the shooter that actually made it so that like the story campaign actually changed what encounters happened, and like you had interesting things that like one leader guy like Elite and the four
Oh, the irony.
millions who would, yeah, it was Halo. Like Halo changed all that,
There is
and
no doubt about the fact that these guys know how to do a good shooter. There's no doubt about that. Like these are talented people at Bungie. I just like I'm fairly certain they've been reined in by Activision and been told, let's take the most conservative route possible to make as much money as possible.
No, but like here's the weird thing. Like Activision, like if they were like imposing their creative design on them, then Activision would be telling them to go the cinematic FPS route, you know, like Call of Duty. Like it wouldn't make sense for me, like if I
Well,
was
no,
like an Activision
it
suit.
doesn't make sense for Activision either, right? They have to do something different. hence this
Yeah.
MMO FPS kind of like micro MMO, whatever nonsense they're
Yeah.
calling it. I hate all the terms for this so far.
I mean, it's hard for me to call it an MMO when like many reviews are saying that the maximum limit of people in an area is like six.
Yeah, it's not that many
So I
people in an
mean,
area. It's like
yeah.
it's like DayZ, man, dude. It's like just basically server to server. There'll be 10 people on a server, 12 people on a server. DayZ mein kitne hota hai? 16 max.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, Daisy has a lot because it's on the Arma engine thing.
Yeah,
So
yeah, yeah. So
Daisy
I
has a
mean,
lot of them.
here there are six, and even like I mean, fine, Borderlands 2, literally, like this is literally like
Yeah.
Borderlands 2, according to me.
Yeah, it's basically Borderlands, yeah. Oh, I mean, I was saying that Borderlands actually like had stuff like weapon randomizations and like lots of elemental effects and like the quest design was like not like exactly like top of the line, but it was fairly decent. And like some of the humor slash setting thing was like everything basically Borderlands reminds like Borderlands 2 reminds me of like you know that thing where like a guest is about to come to your house, so you just like throw everything together to like to somehow like so to somehow like make a dinner for them.
It's like how India put together the Commonwealth Games at the last minute and then we pulled it
Yeah,
off.
basically, yeah. So it's like okay, this thing isn't perfect, but somehow this thing compensates, and but then that thing isn't perfect, but this thing compensates. Yeah, it's like that. But in this case, yeah, I don't think it's just missing a lot of the Borderlands stuff.
It is, and I think it's not the class-based stuff. I think they have some interesting class-based stuff in there. It is just down to, I think, encounter design at the moment. I like maybe they're going to increase the number of enemies later. Maybe the game really comes into its own once you reach the level cap and you're doing end game stuff. Maybe all that will happen. Like a lot of MMOs have a long tail, so maybe like once they've built up their audience and people have been playing for a while, the shape of what Destiny actually is will start to become clearer. But at the moment, it seems kind of bland, which is really, really sad. Because I was hoping that Bungie would deliver. Like, I've really enjoyed the Halo games.
Yeah.
So I
I
was
mean, I
hoping.
actually wonder if like somebody at Bungie is saying, mate, maybe we should have implemented a lot of our features first before launching. I don't know what's happened there.
Yeah,
I
I'm
mean,
fairly
if
certain. Go ahead.
no, I mean, if their plans are to be believed, then this is some like this basically combines like four genres and like has like content so you can play this for a year and like every time something new happens. But what like I'm reading is that it's like 8 hours of game, which then like expects you to repeat it multiple times just to get like the next tier of something. So I don't know, like it feels like they just forgot like implementing half of their stuff and felt like, oh yeah, it will we'll implement that later. Our players will surely stick around for like 2 years while we do this. So
I don't know.
like I
The
would really
last.
want to know like what the story behind the development, because I mean you remember the thing, right? The initial reveal where like they flew out like half of the journalist population of the world to show them a bunch of concept art. I mean literally like some concept art.
Like a couple of stills, I think, and a logo that was what everybody.
Yeah, and
Oh,
everybody
gosh.
like at that time everybody came out of it saying, what the fuck did we just see? Like
Yeah. I still think a lot of people are saying rightly, according to me, that it looks beautiful. It's just
no,
that
yeah,
they're
it
kind of.
definitely looks beautiful. Yeah.
It's just that it's very underwhelming in terms of gameplay. I don't know, man. The last, I think, AAA game that came out that exceeded everyone's expectations and was a very fun game to play, I think, was Wolfenstein: The New Order. I
Wait,
don't think
which
anything's
game
come out
again?
of the new
Wolfenstein.
Wolfenstein.
I have
Oh,
yet
the
to
new
play that. I've
Wolfenstein.
been
Yeah.
waiting to buy it, but it's just too expensive at the moment. I mean, it's really weird considering, like, every big AAA game that, like, everybody has bet big on. Watch Dogs was kind of like this, Destiny, and what's the next big release coming out?
Now, like, I think no
Or
big release
Dragon
until
Age?
October.
Well, Call of Duty, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, there's
And
like, I guess, whenever the next Call of Duty ships, and then what else is there? Though I think at this point, nobody really expects anything from Call of Duty. I mean, the fans know what they'll get, the critics know what they'll get, and like Activision know what they'll get.
well, I mean,
So,
I
like,
guess the
everyone is
market is
just.
expecting it. The market is expecting it to do well. But aside from that, you're right. Like, everybody knows exactly what it is and they're fine with it. It's
Yeah.
the annual comfort food for a lot of people, you know?
Yeah. I mean,
And
at
I think
this point, it's kind of like a repeated sports thing, kind of, you know, like every year some cup happens and everyone kind of knows what will happen. So, yeah, I guess.
yep. Pretty much. Oh, the Shadow of Mordor thing comes out at the end of this month. I have pre-ordered that, so I hope it's good.
Oh, I had forgotten about that. I was actually excited for the
Wait,
game and looking forward to it.
yeah, when you said pre-order, I just remembered that I had pre-ordered Civilization Beyond Two Souls. Or wait, no,
Beyond
Civilization
Earth.
Beyond Earth,
Oh
yes.
man, not again.
Beyond Two Worlds.
Yeah.
What is
But
it?
yeah,
Is it
like, so.
It's Brothers: A Tale of Two Sons, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Look at that, Aswin, you confused him.
Yeah, it's not my fault. Like, why do these people name all of their games the exact same thing? Like,
It's not
B
same,
colon
it just
something else.
starts with B.
Yeah,
And
it's
B, no,
basically
and
that.
then it has a colon. It's like one word and then colon something else.
Yeah, and then like there's a number, like, for some reason, like, so.
Alien Isolation's coming out. I hope that. No, you played that and you thought it was shit, right, Arvin?
No, I wouldn't say shit. I would just say like it was not something new, and like I felt Amnesia what did it better. So, I mean, it felt competent, but like at the same time, then like there was suddenly this section where like all the horror went out of the window. I had a gun and I had to shoot robots, so I don't know where that came from. Maybe they just like they had two movie licenses and thought we'll just like we need to use both of them. So. Yeah, better use them somehow. So,
I
but yeah, like
remember
I don't have any
this time.
expectations.
I remember this
What?
one time when my friend was like telling us about how he played this game for till 5 o'clock in the morning. So he describes the plot as ki, I don't know what I was doing. I was shooting at some Koreans and then suddenly some aliens came. And I kept
Crisis.
wondering what game that was. It turns out it was
Crisis.
Crisis.
I
It
mean
sounds kind of
that's
like
pretty
that.
much.
We're shooting at aliens and suddenly robots आ गए and you're like, okay, वो क्या रहा है यहाँ पे?
Yeah, I mean that's more thought than like the developers of Crytek put into their game, that's for sure. I mean the in the plot, that is. Like Crysis had great like open world stuff and like everything. The AI was actually quite good too, like. And I loved that like you could have them talk in Korean and like or English both, like depending on the difficulty. Yeah, I'll actually, yeah,
Huh.
like I like the first Crysis more than like all of the other Crysis games.
I've not played the any other Crysis game except the first one.
Yeah. I mean, second, I played two, but they made it linear, like.
Yeah, that's
No,
what I
go ahead.
heard.
Oh man, next month this comes out. The Platinum Games Legend of Korra game comes out on
What,
PC.
next month already? Like I thought like it
Yeah.
was just announced like 4 or 5 months
Yep.
ago.
And it's out next month. Man, I
Like
got to get my Steam fixed, you know? It's like I'm so out of touch with games for since a week. More than a week
so
now.
like I'm not.
Oh shit, dude, the sequel to Stealth Bastard is coming out.
But isn't that like PlayStation only? Like that's what
No,
I
it's a
heard.
Wii U exclusive. It's a
It's a
what
what?
exclusive? Wait, is it a Wii U? I think it's a Wii U exclusive. Yeah, it
Wow,
is a
like
Wii U
that.
exclusive.
Wow, like
Bayonetta 2 is
those.
coming out next month, man. Shit. On Wii, and that
Wait,
is
so
also
like
Yeah,
how
and
come
that's a
Platinum.
Wii exclusive.
Like how come Platinum can like announce a game 4 months ago, then like release this alongside
No,
Bayonetta 2. Like, how many?
they've been working on it for 2 years.
Oh.
Yeah, they got the license a while ago.
Okay.
They
Yeah, because I
on the
would be
Legend of
like, I don't
Korra
know,
game.
like. Yeah.
Huh? 2 years
Yeah,
किस
the
पे?
Legend
लेजेंड
of
ऑफ
Korra
कोरा
game.
पे.
या लेजेंड ऑफ कोरा, लाइक आई
ओ
थिंक एटलीस्ट 2 years 18 months, इतना कितना कुछ तो हो गया टाइम.
अच्छा.
या
Yeah, I mean, I would seriously be worried, like, if I was, like, glad, because, like, how many games do these guys, like, put out? Like,
Platinum, they don't put out a lot of games.
I mean,
Like I
this
think
year they also
look
put
at
out, like,
Telltale.
Wonderful 101.
Wonderful 101, like, but they have a huge team now, right? I think it's around 200 people
Okay.
at Platinum right now. तो हर टीम अलग
Oh.
गेम पे काम कर रही है. बट द थिंग यू शुड बी लाइक वेरी अबाउट इज दैट दिस गाय हैज नथिंग टू डू विद इट. कामिया हैज नथिंग टू डू विद इट. इनाबा हैज नथिंग टू डू विद इट. देयर
Okay.
फोर और फाइव कोर गाइज, नन ऑफ देम हैव एनीथिंग टू डू विद इट. दे हैव गिवन अ न्यू गाय अ चांस टू वर्क ऑन इट. सो दैट इज द थिंग यू शुड बी केयरफुल अबाउट. लाइक मिकामी, मिनामी, इनाबा, कामिया, उएदा, नन ऑफ देम आर वर्किंग ऑन इट. दिस
Yeah,
इज
I
लाइक
mean,
अ
I
कंप्लीट.
usually like wait for like reviews and such anyway. I mean, the only games I pre-order now are like Firaxis. So.
Yeah, because but I mean like you can't go wrong with Firaxis, right?
Yeah, I mean, once if I go wrong, then I'll just stop pre-ordering. So, haven't
Yeah.
gone wrong so far. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean Beyond Earth I'm gonna get, and then Lords of the Fallen comes out. So there are some big budget games coming out that could be good, I guess. Also October 14th, Sleeping Dogs Definitive Edition.
What's new in
Sick.
that? Like,
I
it's
already played
definitive.
it.
It's the definitive edition. It's definitive. Oh,
Oh
even
no, I
within
mean,
comes.
so like it has all the DLC, that kind of thing, just Game of the
Yeah.
Year edition, basically.
Well, I mean, it's also like they're doing some high-res texture thing that is new or
Oh,
whatever.
like, and then releasing it on PS4 and so on.
And PC, PS4, PC, and this, but
Okay.
mainly it's for the consoles. Yeah.
Okay. So I guess like this is going to be a common thing now, like.
Oh yeah,
yep.
for sure.
It's console remaster race and PC
Yeah.
master
Yeah.
race.
Yeah, I mean last generation was the HD remake the generation, but now they
Yeah.
can't say HD, so now it's remastered.
And soon it'll be 4K.
Wait a sec.
Yeah.
There is no Call of Duty releasing in November this year? What the fuck?
It's that thing, you know. Activision will keep it secret. Like
Oh God, are
everybody
you?
knows, like.
No, actually it is. It's 4th November, Call of Duty Advanced Warfare.
Oh, okay.
Because them
Yeah.
keeping a secret at this stage is dumb. Everybody knows they release in the first week of November.
Yeah. Yeah.
What is wrong? Like, oh wow, they're actually going to be competing against no one because no one is releasing as usual.
Yeah,
No,
nobody
actually
will
they are.
release then.
Like, I think a week later, Assassin's Creed Rogue and Assassin's Creed Unity come out. What? On the same day, they're releasing two Assassin's Creed games.
I don't know, look, I
Okay.
don't know how Ubisoft thinks, like.
They've gone crazy, man. Unless Wikipedia is completely lying to me. Assassin's Creed Rogue and Unity are coming out on the same day.
I
It
don't
could
like
be.
isn't like Rogue just for like mobiles and stuff? That's what I heard.
No,
No.
no. No,
Rogue
no,
is
no. They're both for
for
PC.
Rogue is for the old consoles, Unity is for the new consoles. That's
Yeah.
what I've understood so far.
Yeah. And they're both for
And
PC,
both
right?
And they're both for PC, yes. Both will be on PC.
Ha ha
I
ha
have absolutely no idea how Ubisoft think. I mean, at this point, I've stopped even like trying to comprehend. So.
Honestly, I found Unity a little more interesting than Rogue. I watched yesterday, I watched a few trailers of both the games. And Rogue is again just an extension of Black Flag. But Unity looks a little interesting. Though again, I'll wait for reviews and for the price to go down. I'm not going to spend 1800 rupees on, recycled
Yeah.
shit.
Yeah. I mean, like, from what I've seen, like, they are, like, combining some Watch Dogs stuff in there. Like, Like I don't know, but yeah, again, like it's Ubisoft. Like all of their games are basically the same. So
Yeah, like
now, like I.
in one of the story missions, I hacked a computer in which, they talk about Cheetos and Bloom, and I was like, wait, I've heard this before, and I'm like, oh wait, it's Watch Dogs. So it maybe it's an Easter egg, or I don't know, maybe they're just hinting that they're kind of going to do something about it. Who knows? Who knows what they're thinking?
Yeah, because really that's what we play Assassin's Creed for, the in-universe continuity of
Basically, all the
the
interesting stuff comes out before October, and in November and December, we don't really have any releases.
yeah, I
They
mean, I
they've
guess
shifted
it's
all the games now for to next year. Evolve was going to come out, and few other games were going to come out, and they've shifted those to
Well,
next year.
actually, you know, there is one game coming out in November, Dragon Age.
Wasn't that in October
Nope, delayed to
or
November.
September?
November
No, it was
18th.
delayed to November, I think.
Yeah. Every game is
Like,
delayed. Oh.
I don't know. I have my eye on it, but at the same time, like, I
Dragon
think
Age left a
it
bad
can go
taste in
either
our
way. Yeah. Because like from what I've seen, like they've gone the way of basically like since people didn't like Dragon Age 2, they have abandoned like they've basically gone back to the BioWare formula. You know that big flowchart that floats around the internet. They've basically like gone back to that and be like, yes.
Yeah,
The
but I don't know. Like it could be more interesting than I have faith in BioWare, man. I don't know. Like I still think that Dragon Age 2, whatever. We've talked about this 1,000 times. No, I'm not talking about Dragon Age 2 again. Fuck that shit.
No, I mean, I just think that like with like this year has been like I've played a lot of games that have like these unique takes on RPGs like Consortium, though I haven't finished it, but like we'll probably discuss Consortium in a later podcast. But like
Okay.
all of these, like even Banner Saga has a pretty unique take on like RPG-ness.
Yeah.
So, and then like BioWare like are just like trying to play it entirely straight, and like so like I'm not sure if that would work so well.
Like I think I realize why I like Banner Saga so much. For most of its like duration, Banner Saga somehow manages to be bleak without being gritty and grim. And I think I like that. I think that's what I like about it. It
I mean,
doesn't.
you are definitely right, yeah.
It's bleak without without the Batmanliness of all the other bleak stuff out there. It's not Game of Thrones bleak.
I
But
mean, I
it's.
feel like, I mean, it is pretty bleak, but at the same time, the thing is that nobody accepts it. I think that's the best way to put it. Like, no character accepts that bleak is the way of life. Like, you know, like in Sin City, for example, like you talk to somebody from Sin City, they'll be like, oh yes, that's how it's always been, and that's like they don't see a world outside like with bleak and like gritty and all of that stuff. You know? I think that's what different, like all of these characters, like they have like they want the world to be better and they want to work towards that. That's what
Okay.
like that's what is
They
different.
have hope.
Yeah.
And they
Yeah.
believe in themselves.
I mean not in themselves, but like in something, basically. Like for
Yeah,
example, some of these
they
they're all
believe and
fighting
they have
for
hope.
something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're all fighting for things other than themselves.
Yeah.
There's like a nobler cause that they're fighting for, which is something you can appreciate.
Yeah. I mean, I actually like the prince character because like he's clearly set up so that you hate him, you know? Like he's one of those like almost like magnets of hate, you know? Like they deliberately put in a character like that to make it. So that actually makes me root for the prince guy because I'm like, yes, prince. Just act like a total prick. Like, I want you to succeed.
That explains a lot about you. Yep, that's not
And
surprising.
plus like, yeah. And plus like, he's pretty great in combat. So that's why like, it made me warm up to him. If he were useless in combat, then I would be just like, I know what you're trying to do with this character. I'll just never use him. But he's actually pretty good in combat. So.
Yeah, like he, like I don't know. I've I found that games like I found like there are very few characters in that game I found boring. There's this one bard that almost never talks. He was kind of boring, but even later on he got interesting, so I don't know. I liked it.
Yeah, I mean none of the characters, like I think none of the characters get too much screen time except like the two main ones. But so like I don't, like at this point I don't remember much of their personality details.
I'd say they're
But
like three or four main ones, but sure, yeah, whatever. Like, I know who you mean. The two
yeah.
guys who are always in every conversation.
Yeah. But yeah, like I mean it's a great game, yeah.
It is a fun ride.
I also like played some Eldritch, but again I think we've talked about Eldritch already, man.
Yeah,
Like
I think it's just fun. Like, I played out Loop Trousers. That's been this
oh
week for
yeah.
me. It is fun. It is fast paced and crazy, and like it's this weird thing that I find about a game like Loop Trousers is that when you see it at a superficial level, at least, it feels like there's nothing new about this experience. And I'd say to a large extent that's true. There's nothing at a core level. There's not a lot of stuff that is new to Loop Trousers, but it's in the presentation and it's the in the way they tune stuff, so that everything from the responsiveness of your plane to the way it fires bullets feels really, really satisfying. Like, I got this plane that basically shoots something whenever it propels itself. So whenever you move forward, whenever you use the boost button to get the plane to move forward, it fires a shot from the back. And that's a really satisfying feeling, to fire stuff from the back of the plane while you're in free fall, and like you can shoot the planes that are dive like in free fall behind you, and you can dive bomb the large battleship below you. It's a lot of fun. Like, they've built a game that is maximized for you to do crazy shit like that. It's fun. It's fast and it's like nuts. That's what I think of Trousers.
You know, I've been noticing this trend. You know, I guess we discussed this before as well, that most of these lesser known or rather non-AAA games are handling games much better. You know, like, you want to play them. They have something which makes them memorable. But in most of the AAA games, they're just simple, bland, and there's just more action that's going on than nothing else.
Yeah.
So
Well, actually, I think it's a little bit reverse. I agree with you, but I think the thing is that the games that we're talking about, the smaller games, right? It's
yeah.
because focus on one or two things is that like they are the simple ones. They are the simple games that like have a couple of things, but because they have just a couple of things, there can be a lot of depth to those two things, and you can explore those two things to a really, really like vast extent. But AAA games, they have a lot of content. They have this huge breadth of content, right? And so everything is a little bit shallow. So
Yeah.
that's why it kind of ends up feeling simple, even though it's not really. It's not really simple. But
Right,
yeah.
right.
But yeah, like, I agree with you.
Because I haven't played any game recently which I would say that, okay, yeah, I want to play this game again, you know. I'm talking about AAA games at the moment. I mean,
Okay.
yeah, they've mostly been disappointing, and they're like, okay, yeah, play and forget, play and forget. That's all they are at the moment.
Yep, I agree.
The only game that I actually enjoyed and went crazy about is Transistor. And that's not a AAA game.
Arvind,
Yes.
Did you play Transistor? Or no?
No, I haven't played it yet.
Oh, you're waiting for it to go on 75% sale. How would you have played?
No,
Oh, wait,
I'm
we were
actually
supposed to
like, yeah, I've
spoil
just
it for
been.
him, right?
Everybody dies in the end.
Wait, that's for Game of Thrones.
Okay, sorry. Everybody lives in the end.
Yeah.
It has amazing music. All right, I've spoiled Transistor for you. So yeah, I agree. I think
And looping all those videos, yeah.
The last game I thought it was well produced and was like really fun to play all around was probably Transistor as well. Weird. It's weird that there hasn't been like a big budget thing this year that has been a blast to play. Like last year there was a shitload of stuff on PS3, like Last of Us and stuff.
Last of Us remastered digitally this year.
Yeah.
I mean, though, seriously, I mean, if somebody, I don't know why they did that. It's a good thing, but I don't know. When is Uncharted coming out, by the way? New Uncharted for the PS4?
No idea. No date has been given yet. 2015 is what they've said. I doubt, like, I'm beginning to doubt that 2015 is doable. I'm thinking it's probably 2016. Considering that Naughty Dog puts in a, like, backbreaking amount of work into titles like Uncharted.
Yeah.
I don't think release something that is subpar. Especially looking current at the current climate where games are getting destroyed for not doing anything interesting with gameplay. They are probably sitting down there and thinking about what can we do that can like make it so that the people who like playing these games are entertained. At the same time, they find something different in what we're doing. And they're probably
I mean, I would rather wait for that game to come out, you know. I mean, at least I'll be able to afford a PS4 by the time the game comes out. I swear that's the only game I bought the PS3 for, and I will buy the PS4 for if I can.
What did I get as soon as I bought a PS3. I think I bought Uncharted 2 as soon as I got a PS3. One of the first things I picked up.
Same here. And God of War, which I had never played. I just remembered I never played God of War. Wow.
That's an insane game.
I don't know. I just never could get into the game. You know, I played the first one. I'm stuck at one place and that's it. I just gave up on it then.
Okay.
Yeah.
I played the first two God of War games. I don't know, like, something happened when I started playing God of War 3, and I'm like, this is too violent for me now.
Achoo.
And I put it down.
Mm.
It's weird. Like, Ninja Gaiden is still not too violent for me, but God of War is, I have no idea why. They both have, like every scene of every fighting moment is like a just bucket filled with blood on the screen. So I don't know why I'm okay with Ninja Gaiden, but not okay with God of War.
Maybe because it was senseless. I mean, maybe they just, you know, show too much of it or something. I don't know.
I have no clue. Anyway. It's still looking to be an interesting year. Lords of the Fallen is something I'm looking forward to. Dragon Age is something I'm looking forward to. You know, there can be some good stuff in the rest of this year.
For me, it's Shadow of Mordor only. Yep.
Shadow of Mordor, same, looking forward to that. And anything made by Platinum Games will probably be good, so there's that.
Yeah, I'll probably pick up Legend of Korra as well. Let's see. None of these horror games I'm going to touch at all. Evil Within, Dying Light, no thank you.
Dying Light isn't horror. Is Dying Light horror? Well,
zombies.
It's zombies. Yeah.
I mean, I'm okay with zombies, but I kind of got shit scared in Last of Us in certain scenes.
Yeah, Last of Us, like, I mean, there are some really good tension building and even, like, some really good scary moments in Last of Us. One of my favorite tension moments is when Joel is upside down.
Oh my god, that
is so
part
well
was
done.
Horrible. I know it is amazing, but for people who are like bad at aiming with controllers, it was a nightmare.
Yeah, it gets weird. It gets really, really weird.
But
oh
I
wow,
mean, good.
This is insane. They're doing a prequel to Orcs and Men.
Yeah, it's a stealth game only, right?
Yeah, it's a stealth game. Styx, Master of Shadows. The first goblin wants to steal the heart of a world tree. It could be good. Could be shit.
Yeah, could be good, could be bad, yeah.
I remember kind of enjoying the story in Orcs and Men. Lightly. Yeah. Weird. Weird that this game like got a sequel. I wonder if they'll be able to make the stealth fun. Yeah. Oh well. Do you guys want to call it? Is there anything else that you want to talk about?
No,
I
not
guess
really.
everybody's too sleepy at the moment.
Yeah,
Oh.
same.
So that's it for this episode of Dead Horse Podcast, and it's goodbye, Vivek,
Bye.
Arvind.
Bye.
Everybody's like asleep now.
Yeah.
So.
For a second, I thought you were building up to something. Vivek, Arvind. And then, like, four other guys join, and then, like, it becomes Voltron or something. I don't
Yeah.
I think, like, everyone's asleep because we talk too much about Assassin's Creed. Like,
Oh,
that's my problem.
Ooh, burn. Oh
Assassin's Creed.
man, seriously.